My first visit in Cuba, what I learned, that if you want to work with handicapped persons, you have to do a very intensive stimulation every day. Very intensive and very, what can we say, it has to be very every day, and it has to be constantly. You just can't walk 1 week, for instance. You have to go on months with a stimulation to do a rehabilitation of handicapped people, so they really have results. That was my first impression to visit Cuba, that the biggest information I got there, it was how intensive it has to be. So that's what I learned in my first travel. But not only that, in the group of person working in this little hospital in Cuba, there were a little man. He was from Vietnam. He was a doctor. And he was doing such a kind of needle work on the face of the patients. And I was so sure he's not doing acupuncture, because he had a map in his hand where he had a planification how to work in each of these patients he was treating. And there were a lot of points. First, when I saw it, I thought, my God, it is 1,000 points, because it was a whole face full of points. And as I told you, he was from Vietnam. And he didn't speak Spanish, only French and Vietnamese. And I have just learned to speak Spanish. So it was my next complication to try to communicate with him. And he was such a very close person. So it was not so easy. But finally, I got some copies of his map with all these points and 4 or 5 other pages with information about the system in France. So when I came back to Argentina, the first thing I did, it was to translate it into Spanish. And then I started up trying to find out what is all these points. It has to do with our nerve system. If it's not meridian from the oriental medicine, it has to be a nerve system stimulation. And I was already working with some doctors in my institute, as I had 11 treating rooms. I rented out for some doctors, and we started up discussing how could it work. And the first experience I had, it was with a young girl who had a car accident. And she was totally paralyzed. She couldn't eat, she couldn't speak, she couldn't only hear and see. And she could, for instance, smell, and she could understand, but she were totally paralyzed. She couldn't swallow. She had absolutely no possibility to take in food in a normal way. So she had a drop with food. And we know when we work with handicaps that it is not very good for a long time to have drop food. Because you know the natural process when you are eating, it is that the food are mixing with the enzymes in the spit, and it is a process who help the whole chemical question in our body. So it was a problem that this young girl, she couldn't eat by herself, and we worked with her with this point, with the facial reflexology. I already had put together different systems, food reflexology, and we tried with this point. And after 3 weeks, she could draw by herself. So she could eat. Of course, somebody had to help her to get the food and the water inside her mouth, but she started up eating by herself. So it was really my first experience with this point. So it was a new, like, amazing thing. I worked every day with new experience with combining these different facial systems, and suddenly it grows for me, like I could put it more and more and more together and make a really system. And 2 years after I did my first visit in Cuba, I formed what we today still call the basic facial reflexology. After that, we started up with all the additional to build more and more and more up from different systems around the world. But 2 years after, yes, the base system were done. And we worked in this way, as every student learns today, to do a base system and use all these nerve points I found in Cuba as an additional to work very specific. So I felt I need to know more about all this. So I went back to the Aboriginal in the Andes, and this second time, when they saw me, they were very happy, and they invited me to live with them. And first I was a little bit shocked, but then I decided I could feel if I said no, there will be not a good tension between us if they expected me to do it. So I spent 10 days with the Aboriginal, sleeping in tents, sleeping on the floor, and learning from the inner side of the group how it was going on. And I realized in this travel that it was only women normally who got the treatment. Men, they only got the treatment if they had a problem. It means this kind of men were by horses the whole day, moving around in the area with sheep so they could eat. And then they come home by night, and if they have a problem because they hit the elbow or the knee, they had a treatment. If not, it was only women. And they started up treating young girls when they were about 14 years, when they had their first period between 12 and 14, and then the rest of the life. And it was very easy to see that it was the oldest women in the group who were treating the younger. It is a little bit different than in our culture, no? It is like younger are treating elderly, but in this culture it is the elderly who are treating the youngest. So when this elderly are getting very old, she can't treat anymore, she learn it to another elderly. That's the way they work. And these women, I never understood how they know when they have to go to treatment. They just know it. They have like a rhythm. They know, now it's mine, next, who is it? They just know it. So I never found out the system. They don't have watches. They live totally with the nature. And when I saw it was very healthy persons, even if they were quite old, in this group of Aboriginal, you can find women who are 150 years old. So they are very old, and they are wrinkled very late in the life. They really don't have wrinkles. They have a very, very nice skin, a very color, nice colored skin, and a very, very nice skin, even if they are maybe 80 years old. And of course you are wondering what is the reason they can have such a nice skin and such a nice color. They are living in a place very near the sun, in an area where we have big problems with the ozone. And even they have a nice color. And even they have less wrinkles than we have, and a lot later. I think my conclusion was that first the peace, they are living totally in peace. They have no television, they have no newspaper, they have no magazines. They don't know anything what's going on in the world. The only thing they know about it is that Argentine money is not good money. It's better if they sell cheese or the wool they do to tourists who is coming to the Balkans. They want dollar. They don't want Argentine people. It's Argentine money. It's a little bit curious. And I was wondering why, what are they doing, what are they needing money for? But they buy horses, that's what they need money for. So they live very, very healthy, they're only eating fish and vegetables. And I saw that they were using an oil for the skin, and it is rosehip oil, and they make it by themselves. They have a lot of rosehip inside the small forest where they have such a kind of trees who is growing very, very near, and they have rosehip inside there. So they do rosehip oil by themselves. And they used to eat a lot of rosehip. When they do oil, the same rosehip who is, after you have done the oil, you have such a mass of rosehip, they eat it. And they eat fish, and they eat meal, and they drink milk, and they drink tea. That is only the only thing they are eating. So it's a very poor quantity of food they have, but it is very good food, very healthy and very pure food. But I think mostly because of the peace. They really live a peaceful life. And I think that it is why they have these wrinkles. And they protect the skin with the rosehip oil. A very big quantity, like more than nearly. They put it on the face and the hands, even the small children, they cover the whole body with rosehip oil. So the rosehip oil for them is like a protection for the sun. Mm? When a woman are pregnant, they use it for the womb too. So they already know that it is good for to maintain their body in all kind of things. So I learned, of course, about the rosehip oil, the way they were living, the system where they were treating with constantly the women were every day doing treatments. And I learned that men, they don't have the same value in this culture, that they don't have maintenance only if something wrong. So it was a very funny and very special experience. But about this technique, I already learned from my first travel, there was nothing new to learn. I have learned what they were doing, nothing else. But even I tried it on my own face. I had the possibility to try to work on the face of some of the elderly women. She could tell me if I was doing well and these kind of things. But of course, my biggest problem was that if I have an area here, I didn't know what it was for. I tried to find out in this year between my first and my second travel, but I was not sure. But finally, I found out, yes, I am right. Because the year after, I went back, and then I had a friend. He was a Mambuche, you have heard maybe heard the name before. It is a very common Argentine Indian, Aboriginal. And this group I were staying with, they are not Mambuche, but they are Pehuenche. The name of them is Pehuenche. But it is like they speak more or less the same language, so he could understand this Aboriginal group, and he did a translation. So I found out later, I got a confirmation later, that I was not wrong. Before I got the confirmation, I found out by myself. I don't know if you know that we have some very sensitive person who knows when you are touching here, they can feel it in the organ. And I was so lucky that I have two patients of this kind who could tell me, you are working with something who has to do with my lung because I can feel some movements around in my lungs. So I really found out by myself in this way before I did my third travel. I went back to Cuba 1 year later too, because I thought I have to find out more about this nerve points technique. And this time I went to Havana, the capital in Cuba, and I went to the biggest hospital because somebody recommended me, an Argentine doctor who was a director in this hospital, to speak with him about my question. And I found him and he said, oh no, it was a project, we had a project with Vietnamese doctors here in Cuba because there's a whole story about a Vietnamese doctor who have done an investigation with a system we call Dinh Cham, who is a Vietnamese, very old, 3,000 years old treatment system. And some staff who have studied with this doctor, they were in Cuba to try how it works in handicapped and in a rehabilitation plan. But now they were not there anymore. But this doctor, he knows everything about it. So he told me how it works, Dinh Cham, and he gave me a book who was written in Spanish, a book I still have. It's not very big, but it contains the most basic of what I have learned of this technique, Dinh Cham. In this moment, Dinh Cham was not called Dinh Cham. It is the name of the very old technique. In Cuba and all over the world where it was well known, it was cybernetic. So I have learned Dinh Cham as a cybernetic method. But it is the same technique with different names. Today, the people who work, or therapists who work with Dinh Cham or cybernetic, they call it facial reflexology. So because of that, sometimes we can have some confusion between one and another system. But the original name of this technique is Dinh Cham or cybernetic. Well, there's a long story about using cybernetic points, and you will of course learn about it in the course. Cybernetic, we use it basically as an additional but a very, very important additional treatment. What I realized in my second travel to Cuba was that in every hospital in Cuba, they do this kind of rehabilitation systems, as I saw first time. It is very, very common in Cuba. It is like the Cuban government, they don't want handicapped patients. It is very expensive to have handicapped patients in a culture. So they decided to do everything the best for handicapped in Cuba. That means that 8 hours of therapy every day in all hospitals in Cuba for handicapped. But of course, Cuba is a communist country, and everybody have the same owning. So even if you are a doctor or the one who cleaned the floor, you have the same salary. If we would do the same in Denmark, it will be, or in England or in Poland, it will be too expensive, because handwork, paying for every hour, it is expensive today. So that's why they found out, instead of doing manual rehabilitation, to use machines. But I think we all agree that it will never be the same. No. I have seen it with my own eyes. The only place in the world I have seen a person who couldn't walk when he gets into the hospital and he could walk out, it is in Cuba. So I really saw it not one time, but several times. I'm totally convinced that if you want to have a result with handicapped, you need to work every day and very intensive. Every single day, the whole year, at least in the beginning. So in the meantime, I did a lot of experience when, from the moment we moved to our biggest institute, the Four Floors Institute, we had about 215 patients every week. So it is about 1,000 patients at month. When I said we, it was me and my 6 assistants. And I, by myself, I worked in this way. I have 3 treating rooms and 3 beds. So I had my assistants doing the basic system of facial reflexology or the basic system of foot reflexology. We still worked a lot with both technique in this moment. The traditional foot reflexology was the school I started off from the beginning in Argentina. I did exactly the same model as the Danish foot reflexology school in Argentina. So I started with it, and later I started up teaching facial reflexology too. But basically, I have my assistant doing the base work, whatever it was, foot or face or maybe both, and then I had 20 minutes to do special combination, special touch on each of the patients. So I went from one bed to another bed to another bed, and when I finish one bed, I have a new one in the first one, and so I did about 30-35 patients every day for 12 years. Every day. Started in 7 in the morning, finishing maybe at 1 at night, or maybe later. So that was the way we worked, and the way we did our experience. And of course, facial reflexology and the way I am working with foot reflexology, it is very different of what other reflexologists does. First, the basic difference is that I am analyzing absolutely all my patients. I just don't do the same on all of them. Of course, they have something very similar in the base treatment, but always some difference even in the base treatment, where it depends where they have the block in the body. And after that, everybody have a special plan which I can only use for them. So that is to learn facial reflexology, and my way to work with foot reflexology today, it is to learn to analyze patient and to do exactly an individual treating plan. As I told you, in this year we did a lot of investigation, for instance, our personal investigation in our institute. We called group of children with different problems. The first group we did, it was with spina bifida, the spinal cord problem. And we did a group of 30 children to see what can we obtain doing facial or foot, a combination of those two treatments with this kind of problems. And we had a lot of good results. Our very first patient with this problem, he was a little boy, he was 6 months old when I started up working with him. He was totally paralyzed from the hips and down. He couldn't move at all for the first six months of his life. His mother, she called me the day after I had treated him for first time to tell me he was moving one of his big toes just a little bit. So that was, you know, the battery who pulled us to really go on. It was fantastic. We was amazed about the result we had. And I could really feel a big, big change from the moment when I started off combining facial reflexology with the foot reflexology. Amazing results and very fast. So of course, because of this result, this little boy, when he was 3 years old, he could walk around by himself. That was why we did a group to try to find out, it is a single case or can we do it with everybody, you know? Then we did a group of 30 children with Down syndrome to see which kind of change can we have if we work with Down syndrome. And the way we did it, because of course, my and my staff, we have so many patients every day, but we did groups of students who did experience. And Argentine students are very, very good for this kind of things, to give their time to really come every day. Down syndrome children, we have them 4 hours a day, 4 days a week in our institute, and they were treated by children. By students. They were treated by students, all 4 hours, 4 days, 4 months. And we did really investigation, writing down what was the case of each of them. Then later we did a group of Parkinson's and we did a group of demence. So it's not only children, it is growing up persons too, we have done our own investigation with. We did a group of 200 women with breast cancer. It was a very, very interesting investigation we did to see what can we obtain. And we did a lot of smaller project too. So it was basically years who was very, very busy. Well, if I finish my work at 12 or 1 at night, I have to do histories because, as I told you, I have to find out for each of my patients what to do. So the first year it was more worksome, of course, but later it was quicker and quicker because you get better and better condition to do it because you will memorize a lot of things. But in the beginning it was quite worksome and I didn't know what I know today. And with all this together, having so many experience, not only in handicap, we have a lot of handicap, but we had a lot of other problems. We have patients with cancer, with kidney problem, with allergy, with constipation. I don't think there's anything we haven't tried. I don't think. So it was not only handicap, but we had a lot of handicap. Let's see, 50% of all our patients were handicapped. Children are growing up, so it was quite a lot if we have 1,000 treatments at month. One little baby, we had an experience. It was when I worked with time, because little by little I tried to educate Argentine patients to ask for an appointment instead of long tails. One day, our parents were coming driving in car about 3,000 kilometers from the south of Argentina with such a little 3 weeks old baby. And she couldn't eat. She had a brain damage. She missed oxygen in the moment of her birth. And she couldn't eat. The mother couldn't breastfeed her. So she was like a little chicken without any t-shirt. She was only bone and skin, and she was screaming constantly. And they didn't ask for an appointment, so it was quite difficult for me to attend this family. But even I told them to wait until late night when I finished my latest patient, and then I would take the time to see this little baby. But you can imagine, if they live 3,000 kilometers away, what could I do? I could do nothing with only one treatment. So when I were treating her, I got an idea. We have to learn the mother something. I didn't ever try it in my life before, but I only felt, how can I just send this family back 3,000 kilometers with nothing? So I called my secretary. I always said she still loved me because it was by 1 at night. And I asked her, please, to come next morning at 6, so we could treat this family, this mother, how she could do some few things by herself. So I used the night to find out how to combine something very simple. And then next morning we teach the mother and the father how they could treat some simple points and areas on the face. And we were talking about it, well, what can we do? It's like, it is a tool, at least we don't feel so helpless. We gave them something, you know? And then we asked them to come back 1 month later. And when they came back with this baby, we couldn't believe. She was really now like, she had a t-shirt, she had a lot of weight, she was smiling, she was not screaming anymore. And of course the mother and the father were smiling too. And they told us 3 days after they started up stimulating with facial reflexology, with these few things only we gave them, the baby started up eating. So of course we thought, oh my God, we have to learn them, we have to learn them some more things, because of course it was not only a question about eating. She had another a lot of other problems, paralysis and spasticity. So we learned the mother more, and then we learned her more. Every month we learned her something new, and finally this baby was in quite good condition. And with this first experience, we started up what we call Tembrana therapy today. Tembrana therapy, who is a specialized rehabilitation program made by reflexotherapy. It is a combination of facial reflexology as the main thing in Tembrana therapy with what I call neurofoot reflexology, who is a therapy I have created by myself during this year, where I have studied all the neurological background of facial reflexology. I did a study about foot in the same moment and created what we call praxis vertebralis. And Tembrana therapy, it is a combination of these two techniques and neuro hand reflexology. And what I have done, it is to build up a therapy who is like in Cuba. I teach the parents and the parents will treat the child or a growing up person. It's not only for children, it is for growing up person too. Every day or four times a month, or no, sorry, at week, or four times, five times a week, whatever. It depends of the case how many times a week they have to train. So facial reflexology just became very important for every day. We had more and more patients who comes for facial reflexology. They didn't want foot reflexology anymore. And during some years we changed to have 80% of all our patient for facial reflexology and only 20 for the traditional foot reflexology. So it was really a big change. Everybody, they wanted to have facial reflexology suddenly. But I never stopped totally work with foot reflexology. I just understood that it is two different therapies who have two different objectives. Facial reflexology, it acts directly in the central nerve system, and foot reflexology, the classical one, acts very much in the blood circulation. So it's two different therapy who acts different, who does different things, and who they are a very, very good combination if you want to do that. It is not that one is better than another one, it acts totally different. Facial reflexology, it acts very directly into the brain and the central nervous system. That is a difference from foot reflexology, who acts very much blood circulation and liberation of hormones in the blood. So it's just to understand how the difference is. So Tembrana therapy and facial reflexology, it becomes very, very well known in the whole Argentina. In the meantime, I did two other schools, one in the capital in Buenos Aires and another one in a city we call Mar del Plata. So I think it has been the most busy 14 years of my life. I have always been busy, but as in Argentina, it was really, really strong years for not only for me, but for my staff too. After I came home to Europe in 2000, I came home to Denmark, and it was like in Denmark, everybody was very interested in facial reflexology. And now it is 8 years ago, and you can see how it is going. We are working now in 22 countries. I have 26 instructors, and now we will have about 8 more instructors. So it's going quite fast. And for 7 years ago, we decided to do like another apartment of facial reflexology, the aesthetical work, Cosmofacial. And Cosmofacial is going strong on too. It is based in facial reflexology too, but it is even different because with Cosmofacial we take a lot care of skin problems. We treat the body, but the objective is a skin care and aesthetical treatment. So that's where we are now, with a lot of new energies around the world. We just started up working in Arabic countries, in Abu Dhabi and Dubai, and in USA. It means that we are in all 5 continents now. That is good. So it is just to go on and to learn how to manage with facial reflexology, and it is very sure that everybody will be very successful.